Consider the three molecules shown here. Based on what we learned in the last webcast, you should be able to distinguish the faces of these alkenes as enantiotopic, homotopic, and diastereotopic. An interesting example of where topic relationships between faces becomes important is the enzyme-catalyzed example that you see at the bottom of this slide. An achiral nucleophile and an achiral electrophile are combined in the presence of a chiral enzyme, an aldolase, to produce an aldol product, and notice that only a single diastereomer is formed from this reaction. This means that two things happened. First of all, the enzyme was able to distinguish the enantiotopic faces of the electrophile. And secondly, the enzyme was able to also distinguish the enantiotopic faces of the nucleophile. That leads to the formation of only a single diastereomer because there's a very specific approach of the nucleophile to the electrophile, and only two very specific faces of the nucleophile and electrophile come into contact. So the immediate question here is, how was the enzyme able to accomplish this remarkable distinguishing of the two enantiotopic faces of each of these molecules? We can get a handle on this if we remember from the last lesson that enantiotopic faces can be distinguished by a chiral probe. Enzymes are certainly chiral probes, as they're made up of chiral amino acids, as we'll learn a little later on, and the chiral probe is able to distinguish the enantiotopic faces of the nucleophile, the nucleophilic enolate, and the electrophile. If the enzyme were achiral, however, we would not see that same kind of distinguishing, which is why if we just mixed up the nucleophile and electrophile from the last slide, for instance, in a flask, we would see a variety of the four possible stereoisomers that could form. The way an enzyme, or really any chiral object, does this is by possessing particular groups in particular positions such that there's an optimal orientation of the chiral object for binding. So for instance, if you consider this substrate here and Dr. Moore's hand as the enzyme, if we note that his thumb is an ideal binding point for the carbonyl oxygen, then only one orientation of the molecule fits the orientation of his hand, assuming that orientation is fixed. So only this orientation is favorable for the binding of the substrate. The carbonyl oxygen in that case is in close proximity to the thumb. If we turn the molecule over, or if we turn it over in a different direction, in both of those cases, the carbonyl oxygen is not oriented well to be close to the thumb. As a result, this binding is non-ideal and no reaction will occur of the substrate. Notice in both of these bottom cases, the exposed face out here is different from the exposed face in this case. We have one enantiotopic face exposed in the top case, but in the bottom case we have the opposite enantiotopic face available for reaction. Because the binding is non-ideal, however, we won't see reaction when that enantiotopic face is available. We use the descriptors Re and Psi to describe different enantiotopic faces. The way we do this is by orienting the molecule such that we're looking down on the face of interest, then examining the priority of the three groups that define the plane that we're looking at. If the three groups are oriented in a clockwise fashion from highest to lowest priority, then we're looking at the Re face. If the groups are oriented in a counterclockwise fashion from highest to lowest priority, then we're looking at the Psi face. Turning the molecules over allows us to look at the opposite face.